And I was a very lonely young fella in Dublin, having come down from the north. I used to wander into the National Gallery, and I think it was the loneliness of the El Greco, his tapering loneliness, that drew me in. I identified with a lot of that, and I loved his imploring hands looking up towards some hidden divinity. I'm looking out through a window in Seville Place, which was in the old Dublin. I think there was a questionable house only a few houses away. In any case, there were ladies wandering around. I was thinking about going out to the west of Ireland and being an old-style monk. So I said that led me to think about St. Francis. And the poem came in four stanzas, the alternation between identifying with the hermit and the desire to be in one's own life.
Until the quietude of the senses announces presence of a guest. Desolation final, rock within and rock without, till from the stubborn rock of the heart the purifying waters spurt.
There's a kind of jealousy involved, because painting is so much more physical. I mean, you actually, with my friend Barry Cook, I remember he used to be in a kind of almost ecstasy, and he explained to me what the various colours were and how you could mix them and all that. And then getting down at the canvas, it seemed to be a very highly erotic process. And of course, I was moving into the erotic with pleasure.
Remarkably, in all this time, I have been powered by that small red remnant core in the clouded blackness. I cannot determine between them which one is the growth. For this is the landscape of my heart, and into its chambers never was a slower needle driven.
When I came to choose the painting, what I saw was the landscape of a heart. I know that that's not going to be the same thing that everybody else is going to see, but it was what I saw. I think it was the combination of the darkness, that red core, and the light that made me see something that could be a heart that was damaged and that had hope. So there were these three elements involved, and the sense that a heart that has been damaged is the damage drawing closer and closer, and will that part that is working be engulfed, or will that part grow and grow and the heart will be restored? Which part of the outcome of loss will triumph? We'd all like to think it's that red remnant core as I've described it, but could it be the blackness? And obviously the blackness is the most imposing part. Nobody wants to be hopeless at the end of something like that. So the question, I suppose, is posed, as it is in life, for everybody to decide how they proceed after a loss. Will they succumb to the darkness, or will they focus on the light? That's why we all do this. We create a world, we create emotion. It's all about emotion, whether it's a dark, nasty crime novel or it's a story of love and romance. Emotion is at the heart of it. And I think emotion is at the heart of your interactions with art.
Look at that painting, you think, well, where are they going to go? And you kind of know how it's going to end, you know, probably in emigration, and you know, most likely death. But it's the first thing you think, like, what are they going to do? You know, there's an old man there, there's a child, there's a woman with a baby, you know, you get kind of a sickening feeling when you look at it. Even though it's a very beautiful painting, you know, the sky is so beautiful, the light in the east and the darkness in the west, it's just, it's gorgeously done. I just stared at it for ages, and because maybe he's the central figure in the painting, the father kind of fascinated me. Even the way he's standing, the way he's looking back, the height of his chin and the straightness of his back, you know, how he does seem so unbowed by this. And you kind of think, is this maybe his fault somehow? You know, did he really mess up here? You know, did he really go against the landlord and kind of invite this on himself and his family? And then you start feeling, God, I shouldn't think that because, you know, there's a way that I should be looking at this picture. You know, I should be looking at the family as the victims and the landlord or the landowner as the bad guy here. But you can't help going back to the father again and saying, you know, why does he look so defiant, you know? The scene that's being played out in the painting is an age-old story. In Erskine Nicholls' time, it would have been fairly ubiquitous. And there's definitely the same kind of ubiquity now, because we see that scene played out in Ireland. You know, you hear stories of people, you know, in serious default, pretty much being uprooted, cast out from their homes. I heard language described recently, just in the last few days, as just a series of noises that are used to create an image in another person's mind. And it's a very simple and powerful description of language. It's exactly what it is. And that's a challenge, because, you know, I can see something very clearly in my own head, and I can feel the emotion that I want to convey on the page, but it can be very hard at times to make that clear on the page. It can be a real struggle. The best books I've read are where you don't feel that the writer struggled in any way to make you see these pictures.
It felt to me very like the kind of reverie out of which poetry can come. It's three paintings in the one painting. It's the painting itself. It's this painting, perhaps unfinished, on his easel. And it's this other little mysterious painting that I thought was an abstraction, but turns out to be a shirt on a chair with a yellow door in the distance. In fact, my way into this poem, the poems that came out of this, was through a painting. I made a small cartoon where I have a female figure, but it was a way of me examining closely what is there visually in his work, working towards a language of my own. The red fox looked me squarely in the eyes to reassure me vision never dies if rooted in truth. So paint what you mean about snow, tree, paths, and mean what you paint. Both paintings and poetry have always, to me, interwoven. I think a painting offers a similar space, not the same space, but a similar space to a poem, to a certain kind of poem, the more interior poem, in that space where you just go into the enchantment of what's made. And it's a very private transaction between you and what you see, as poems can be a very private transaction between you and what you read. The thing I do love about Dylan is that he paints everything with what I can only describe as love. It's just this this kind of attention in space, which is a kind of attention I would like to bring in my own work, you know, to write out of that affection for the world.
This process was different for me, and it was eye-opening, really, because I hadn't thought of doing that before, to take a painting and be inspired by it. The painting I picked, of course, was The Doll's House. And it had been in my life a long, long time, because we had a print of it in my daughter's room. So she kind of grew up with this painting. And the reason we had a painting in the first place is because she reminded me of the girl in the painting. She would play with her dolls like that, line them all up on the bed and beg us, if anybody called, to tell them not to, that she was sick or that she wasn't going out or she wasn't in or she was in her granny's or whatever the story was. She was going to play the story out in her for the whole rainy afternoon.
She just wanted to be on her own playing with her dolls at her age. And as for her friends were not needed, they were not wanted. General Grady would look to Rosie Ryan then for confirmation, but Rosie would not say a word. She'd just stand there and look down at her shoes, mortified.
Well, you know, like most things that we're born to write, they're inclined to just unfold. I've tried to force things on me, stories that I wanted to write, and I always had to abandon them. So, but things that do work and come to fruition, and I find I can't quite remember how. I don't remember writing it, for example. But of course, also locked into this thing is, you know, that little girl is me, because that's what I do. I kneel actually beside my bed and write. And I've always done that, kneeled beside the bed, and I play. I'm a playwright, so I play with combs and brushes and pencils, and they become characters. And you know, if I had toy soldiers, that's not a bad idea actually. I would play with toy soldiers to become my characters. So you know, I'm part of that too, and I don't want anyone knocking on the door and annoying me, and I don't want any negative thoughts coming in while I write. Because there's only me in this thing, in the story.
When I was on board in Poetry Ireland years ago, it was always the first thing I would do, go in just to see that Barry was still there, that Clemente's, the frightened artist, was still hanging on that wall. You always feel about that painting that Timanthes has just been startled by your coming to look at him. And it's that startled look of art interrupted that I loved about the painting, you know. When you're asked to write about a painting, the response again has to be considered. And the image means so much to me as an artist. It's one of the great kind of companion images of my life, you know. And I'm, in a sense, sorry for Timanthes and feel pity always for Barry. Because for James Barry, life was very difficult. Mainly because James Barry made it difficult. He was cranky, petulant, abusive, insulting, paranoid, poverty-stricken, mean, grasping, envious, brilliant. That he achieved that painting, that he achieved such a sublime work of art, is really a reminder that it is spectacular that we became involved in the human condition, that we evolved to where we are now. And nothing is as classical or as brilliant as the present moment. It just reminds me of that. And like, that's why each present moment when I come up to Dublin, go on the Lewis into the city centre and walk down to the National Gallery and walk up to the painting, I am reminded that this is an absolutely brilliant present moment.